Okay, now, if my lips are not matching my voice, then I gotta tell you, it's a lot easier to research biblical history and even some strange phenomenon than it is to figure out why my video camera is off. Okay, I've tried changing some things, so I'm hoping maybe this time around we can get both of them going at the same time. If not, just don't look at the picture, just listen. Anyway, in this time around on this video, we're going to look at creation. We are going to look at Genesis 1. We are going to look at Genesis 2 of creation. So, with that, I invite you to open up your Bibles. We're gonna keep flipping back and forth too, okay? So this is gonna take a little bit. I know you probably, you know, it's funny. When somebody teaches you something, you usually have a whole lot of questions. It's like the more you uncover, the more questions you get. And sure, many of you have a lot of questions, especially as to why I brought up Edgar Cayce, all this other stuff. We are going to get there. But in this session, I need to lay some groundwork. I need to show you some things. So if you have not watched, hopefully you will watch these videos in numbered succession. Because I'm not, other than making a reference to something, I'm not going to be repeating anything as I go along. Okay, Genesis 1, we're going to take a look at that. We're going to look at Genesis 2. And we are going to look at creation. Okay, now as we've already discovered, Genesis 1:1 and 1:2, there's a big period of time there that something took place, and then now we are moving on to creation. Okay? First thing that I would like to bring to your attention between Genesis 1 and Genesis 2 accounts of creation is that if I told you find two things that are consistent and the same, you will find that there's only one, and it has nothing to do with either of the two chapters. Now, by that, I mean if I told you find two things in creation of Genesis 1 and the creation account in Genesis 2, please find me two things that are exactly alike. You know what? You're not going to find them. Okay? Many people, they just go rattling through Genesis 1, Genesis 2. They make an assumption that one is the same as the other. We've been taught that in Genesis 1, this is creation. And then we're taught that Genesis 2 is just filling in, you know, reiterating some things that's in Genesis 1. My question is, how on earth could they be the same creation if everything is different in both accounts? And that is what we're going to look at. The first difference I want to look at is chronology. Chronology is the order of things. You know, if you do things in a certain order, and we do know that our Lord God is orderly, you would expect that if another chapter is going to explain it in detail, that the chronology isn't going to change. In this case, it does. Okay, let's look at Genesis 1. It may take me a moment to find some of these things. I mean, I have some highlights, but okay. I want to bring your attention to day 3 in Genesis, and we're going to go to verse 11 and 12. And God said, "Let the earth bring forth grass, the herb yielding seed, and the fruit tree yielding free fruit after his kind, whose seed is in itself upon the earth." And it was so. Now we're going to go to verse 12. And the earth brought forth grass and herb yielding seed after its kind, and the tree yielding fruit, whose seed was in itself after his kind. And God saw that it was good. So here we are. We got plants. We're going to start with plants. Okay? In fact, get a piece of paper and jot these down. Make the list. We're going to make two lists, one on one side, one on the other side. Okay. So write down plants. The next thing that we're going to look at is over in verse 20. It says, "And God said, let the waters bring forth abundantly the moving creature that hath life, and fowl that may fly above the earth in the open firmament of heaven." So here we have, after plants, we have birds. Okay, birds. So I want you to write down birds and fish, because that's just what we talked about. The next place I want to take your attention is verse 24. Now this is on day 6 of creation. "And God said, let the earth bring forth the living creature after his kind, cattle and creeping thing, and beasts of the earth after his kind, and it was so." So put down animals. First plants, then birds and fish, then animals. Now in the same 6th day of creation, let's go to verse 26. It says, "And God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth." So number 4, we have man. Okay? First plants, then birds and fish, then animals, then man. So let's skip on over to Genesis 2. And let us look at the chronology. Let us find a starting point. Verse 4. You know, honestly, Genesis 2, I have no idea. They should have ended Genesis 1 with where Genesis 3 is. Okay? Because that's finishing up the 7th day of the creation account in Genesis 1. And really, Genesis 2 should have really started at the 4th verse. Okay, these are the generations of the heavens and of the earth when they were created in the day that Lord God made the heaven, the earth, and the heavens. All right, verse 5. "And every plant of the field before it was in the earth, and every herb of the field before it grew, for the Lord had not caused it to rain upon the earth, and there was not a man to till the ground." Okay, so we're talking about vegetation. And it says, "And there went up a mist from the earth and watered the whole face of the ground." Okay, so there we are. There we have, number 1, we have the plants. Because the Lord is saying that there's no man to till the ground. So obviously that part of the creation is created first. So we're going to say plants. Okay? Then in verse 7, And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. So after that, he creates man. So number 1, we got plants, vegetation. Number 2, we have man. Okay? Number 3. Verse 8, And the Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden, and there he put the man whom he had formed. So now God plants a garden in Eden. Okay? And then he puts the man in it. So there's no mention of any Garden of Eden in Genesis 1. You won't find it. Then it goes on to describe 4 heads of rivers, what they're known for, how they connect, and then we go on to verse 16, where God tells man, okay, verse 15, he takes the man, puts him in the garden, tells him to dress it and to keep it. And in verse 16, God commands the man that of every tree he can freely eat. But there's only one tree in the whole garden, right there in the center, that he cannot eat from. Okay? And then it says, this is funny, in verse 18, the Lord God said, "It's not good that man should be alone. I'm going to make a helpmate for him." So what does he create him? Animals. Isn't that funny? So now we have, it says, number 19, "Out of the ground the Lord God formed every beast of the field, every fowl of the air, and brought them unto Adam to see what he would call them." Okay? So now he creates the birds and the animals after Adam, because he's looking for a helpmate. It's a different chronology. Now, after all that, then God creates a woman for Adam. Now, the word Adam is not a name. Adam means man, Adam, okay? Think about pre-Adamic man, and here we have Adam. Okay, so here we are. Let's look at the chronology. In Genesis 1, first we have plants, then we get birds and fish, then we get animals, then we get man. Genesis 2, first we get plants, then we get man, then we get a Garden of Eden that was never mentioned, then we get the birds and animals, and then Eve is created very last. So there is one difference right there. The next difference I would like to bring your attention to are the birds. In Genesis 1, go to verse 20, and God said, "Let the waters bring forth abundantly the moving creature that hath life, and fowl that may fly above the earth in the open firmament of heaven." What were the birds created of? The water? Interesting. The birds were created of the water. Genesis 2, verse 19. "And out of the ground the Lord God formed every beast of the field and every fowl of the air." The birds. Yeah. So in chapter 2, they're created out of the earth, but in chapter 1, they're created out of the water. Okay, let's go for another one. There's a word I want to show you that's very interesting here in Genesis chapter 1. If you go to verse 28, it says, "And God blessed them, and God said unto them, Be fruitful and multiply and replenish." Replenish. What does replenish mean? Well, replenish means to fill something up again, or to restore to the former level or condition. Isn't that interesting? In verse 28, this is when God creates in Genesis 1, man, and he says, "And replenish the earth." I just want to draw your attention there, because in verse 1 and 2 of Genesis 1, there is a long span of time where there was mankind. And now they're going to replenish the earth again in Genesis 1. Just an interesting thing there. Okay, now the next difference. I want you to read why man was created in Genesis 1. Okay? Before we get to that point. In verse 28, God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea and the fowl of the air and every living creature that moveth upon the earth." God gives them a command. Hey, go multiply. Fill the earth, multiply. Okay? Okay? Genesis 2. In verse 5, it says, "God had not caused it to rain upon the earth, and there was not a man to till the ground." Skip down to 7. "And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground, and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. And the Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden, and there he put the man whom he formed." Okay? Verse 15, "And the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it." He didn't even create Eve at the same time. See, in Genesis 1, they're both created and told to multiply. But in Genesis 2, that's not what he did. God didn't even create a woman for him, okay? He put him in the garden to take care of the garden. That was his job, not to multiply and create. In fact, when God first makes a helpmate for him, he's making him animals. And it's only after he's like, you know, I love the animals, Lord, and everything, but I need somebody that's like on my level. And then he creates Eve. And even when the Lord God creates the woman for Adam, never is he told to multiply and be fruitful. Never told that. In fact, it not only didn't he tell him that, but when you go to verse 25, it says, and they were both naked, the man and his wife, and were not ashamed. They didn't even know they were naked. Come on. They didn't know what being fruitful and multiplying even was. Okay, they were there to take care of this garden, and that is where God placed them. Unlike the creation going on in Genesis 1. Now I'm going to bring another difference to the table. Okay? I'm not sure which of the two to bring first, because they're both huge. And this is where the controversy is going to begin. Okay, I learned this truth through listening to someone else who is more better on this subject than I am. So I would recommend you going over to his channel if you want to know more about what I'm about to show you, because this is something that the Lord showed him. There are other people that the Lord showed this to as well, but this is the one who I believe that the Lord has given him some spiritual gifting. And oh my gosh, there is so much more. This is just one little thing in the whole scheme of things on his channel. This channel is called TheJonathanKleck.com. TheJonathanKleck.com, K-L-E-C-K. Not .com, the Jonathan Kleck channel. If you go on YouTube, just type in Jonathan Kleck. You will see where the Jonathan Kleck websites come up. He's got a lot of enemies out there, a lot of people, a lot of haters, but he has a very good ministry from the Lord. So now I'm going to get into this teaching. There is a huge difference between Genesis 1 and Genesis 2, and I'm going to see if you can catch on to this. Verse 3, and God said. Verse 4, and God saw. Verse 5, and God called. 6, and God said. 7, and God made. 8, and God called. 9, and God said. Okay? All the way through the entire Genesis 1, up to where I said it should have ended in verse 3 of Genesis 2, everything is God this, God that, God said, God did, you know, God made. But what's really strange is when you go to Genesis 2, where it correctly should begin at verse 4, there is a difference. And now I'm going to read it through some of the other ones and see if you can catch this. Verse 7. And the Lord God formed man. Verse 8. And the Lord God planted. Verse 15. And the Lord God took. 16. And the Lord God commanded. Verse 18, and the Lord God said. Have you seen the difference? I'm sure you do. In Genesis 1, everything that's created is by God. G-O-D, just God. But in Genesis 2, everything is created by the Lord God. Lord God, Why would there be a difference between Genesis 1 and Genesis 2? It's just kind of odd, isn't it? Well, the thing that I'm trying to point out right here, and I hope I have enough time to get this on this film, is that when you look up God, let's go to, and this is from, as per Jonathan Cleck, this is where I have learned this little piece of truth that just changes everything. All right. We are going to look up God in our concordances. Okay? And for some reason, my page, here it is. Okay. It is number H430 in your Strong's Concordance, and it is a plural word. Okay? I'm here to tell you, our Bible says, "Hear, O Israel, our God is one God, just like the egg, he's one God." Okay? When Jesus refers to any part of the Godhead, he refers to the Holy Spirit as the Comforter, singular, God the Father, the Father, singular, and when the Father refers to himself, I am. He doesn't say we are. He says I am. We have one God. He is not a plural. Okay? Anyway, let's see what H430 is in the Hebrew. It is the word Elohim. It is plural of H433, meaning in this instance, it is plural. Interesting. Remember, I told you when we went into Colossians, God has layers of angelic beings, and all things were made by him and for him. Okay, I want you to remember that. Elohim, what is that? It says God's, small g in the ordinary sense, but specifically used in the plural, thus especially with the article of the Supreme God, not the Supreme God, of the Supreme God. That's what that means. Occasionally applied by way of deference to magistrates. God is not a magistrate. He created the magistrates. Okay? Not referring to Father God here. And sometimes as a superlative, angels, exceeding. And even where it says God in parentheses, it's a little g, gods. Great judges, mighty. So, the word God throughout Genesis 1 is Elohim, plural. It is plural. It is angels. It is the angelic host. So, okay? I want you to stay with me. Because we're about ready to run out of time, and I know I'm going to need some time on this, because I still have to show you a couple of things. We're going to go to Genesis 2, and we're going to look up Lord God. Okay? And when we look up Lord God, it is Yahuwah or Yahuwah or Jehovah. Okay, the Lord God. It is number H19 from, it is from H1961. Do you remember that number? When we looked up H1961 in Genesis 1, it meant the word became. Remember H1961? Well, it's the same thing here. It says it comes from H1961. I didn't even notice that till I put this together. Anyway, let's see what H3068, Lord, before the word God, means. It means the self-existent or eternal Jehovah. Jewish nation, national name of God, Jehovah, Yehovah, the Lord, okay? We are talking about God. We are talking about the Godhead in Genesis 2. When we look at Genesis 1, every little piece of creation is being done by something else. Okay? Under Genesis 1, these things are being done and they are good. These are actions that are being carried out by the Elohim, by our living God, by the Godhead. Okay? I'm getting near the end of this tape, and there is more between Genesis 1 and 2 that I need to get to and show you to reiterate this. So, with that, be blessed.